Welcome to week 5 in e-learning week. In this online lecture, we will continue our discussion of biogeochemical cycles by focusing on the carbon cycle. In particular, we look to answer 4 key questions. First, what determines how reservoirs, such as the atmospheric carbon dioxide reservoir, respond to imbalances to the flow of materials to and from them? 2. Which reservoirs and processes are important to the recycling of carbon and other essential nutrients in the Earth system? 3. Do feedback mechanisms regulate the amount of atmospheric carbon dioxide? And 4. How do nutrients limit biological productivity on Earth? The recycling of elements among the components of the Earth system is key to the continued functioning of Earth as a living planet. Although many elements are critical, none is more central to the workings of the Earth system than carbon. All life is based on carbon. Gaseous carbon dioxide is an important greenhouse gas. The acidity of the ocean is regulated by carbon compounds, and the maintenance of an oxygen-rich atmosphere depends on the transfer of carbon to sedimentary rocks. To perform these functions, the carbon cycle involves a hierarchy of subcycles that operate on different timescales, ranging from decades for the replenishment of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere to hundreds of millions of years for the recycling of carbon through sedimentary rocks and the exchange of carbon within Earth's interior. Both biological and physical processes are involved in the recycling of carbon, and they are so closely intertwined that it becomes difficult to separate the two. In this lecture, we trace the movement of carbon as it cycles through the Earth system, and we develop the additional concepts of steady state and residence time along the way. We also discuss nutrient elements, because the rate of carbon recycling depends strongly on the rate of nutrient recycling. Why is Earth the only planet in our solar system that supports life? The direct answer is that Earth is the only planet that has liquid water at its surface. But part of the reason Earth is able to maintain liquid water is that our planet has natural recycling systems for the elements essential for life, including carbon, nitrogen, phosphorus, and sulfur. These recycling systems are ultimately linked with the global process of plate tectonics. The link between tectonic activity and the carbon cycle is important to the regulation of atmospheric carbon dioxide concentrations and thus to climate as well. The winds and ocean currents and the moving lithospheric plates make up Earth's circulatory system. They transport energy and material to different parts of the Earth system, where they are utilized in biological and physical processes. This mixing of Earth's fluid and solid parts also helps accomplish an important task, the recycling of the elements. Essential elements are released to the biosphere, that is, the part of the Earth that supports life, including oceans, atmosphere, land surface and soils, as rocks weather, volcanoes erupt, and nitrogen is made available from the atmosphere by chemical transformations stimulated by lightning discharge. Compared with the rates of utilization by the biota, these releases are very slow. They would support only very low rates of biological activity, where they're not highly efficient nutrient recycling mechanisms. Nutrients are substances, normally obtained in the diet, that are essential to organisms. Nutrient elements are incorporated into living tissue during growth and rapidly return to the soil or ocean on death. This cycle is repeated many times before the elements are lost from the biosphere, mostly as constituents of sedimentary rocks. The situation is much like our recycling of aluminium cans. Recycling substantially reduces our dependence on the extraction of aluminium from Earth and allows us to produce aluminium products much more rapidly. Similarly, element recycling within the biosphere allows for much higher rates of biological productivity. As an introduction to just one part of the global carbon cycle, imagine that we could follow the carbon atom of a carbon dioxide molecule as it cycled through the terrestrial part of the cycle. The carbon in carbon dioxide is inorganic carbon. It is not associated with compounds formed by living organisms and it does not contain carbon-carbon or carbon-hydrogen bonds. After spending nearly a decade moving with the winds in the troposphere, the gaseous carbon dioxide molecule will have visited both the northern and southern hemispheres several times. Then, one spring, say, during the annual greening of the northern hemisphere, the carbon dioxide molecule passes through a small opening in a leaf, the photosynthetic apparatus of a plant. Through a frenzy of collisions with other molecules and atoms, the oxygen atoms are ripped from the molecule, while hydrogen, nitrogen, and other carbon atoms become attached. Our carbon atom, as part of the leaf, is now organic carbon. Some leaves are consumed and digested by animals. The carbon in these leaves is then released back to the atmosphere by the animal's respiration as carbon dioxide. Suppose summer passes and autumn arrives, and the leaf that contains the carbon atom has not been eaten. The nourishing substances and water that the leaf has received from the tree have ceased to flow. The leaf is released from the branch and settles to the ground. Other leaves fall on top, burying it in a thick mat of decaying matter. The carbon atom is part of the soil, where it will remain for about the next 50 years. By the end of that time, bacteria and fungi will have decomposed the organic matter that contains the atom. The chemical reactions that result transform the carbon atom once again into gaseous carbon dioxide molecules, which escape back to the atmosphere. This life cycle of a carbon atom is repeated nearly 500 times on average before a leak occurs. Once in a while, before the organic matter that contains the carbon atom decomposes, the soil erodes and is transported by rivers to the oceans. There it settles with other particles to the seafloor and is buried by subsequent sediments or carried with its underlying oceanic plate deep into the subduction zone. Under elevated temperatures and pressures, the carbon atom may be converted into gaseous carbon atoms and escape to the surface, or be converted into the components of sedimentary or metamorphic rock. The carbon atom may spend millions of years in the sedimentary metamorphic rock reservoir as mountain belts form, thrusting deeply buried rocks through the Earth's surface and beyond to great elevations. Eventually, our carbon atom will be transferred from its burial place within Earth's interior to the surface. Here, environmental forces, both biological and physical, will cause the sedimentary rock containing the carbon atom to disintegrate during a process known as weathering. In this process, the organic carbon reacts with oxygen from the atmosphere and forms inorganic carbon dioxide, which escapes as a gas to the atmosphere. The weathering process, then, is the connecting link in the long path this particular carbon atom has taken, from the atmosphere to the plant, to the soil, to the sediment, to the sedimentary rock, and then back to the atmosphere. The path of the carbon atom has taken encompasses the terrestrial organic carbon cycle, operating on timescales that are short, years to decades say, and those that are long, centuries and millennia to multi-million years. If instead, however, of being incorporated into a plant leaf, the carbon atom had entered the ocean and been converted to organic carbon by marine algae, it would have become part of the marine organic carbon cycle. There are a host of processes not involving organic carbon that compose what is known as the inorganic carbon cycle. This is the end of part 1.